words. The Glendale Road Church of Christ proudly presents a weekly exploration of the Word of our living God. This is It Is Written with Minister Stephen Hunter.
Oh, let the ancient words impart.
This particular lesson might be uncomfortable for some, but it's something that I think really needs to be covered. And that is, there are some of you that are here, you've been coming here for a good time, and maybe you were taught one way or another where you grew up going to church, but since you've been coming here, you've been to Bible classes, you've heard several sermons, and what we have taught here as what one must do to be saved is different than what you have previously learned. And maybe in your mind you're convinced that we teach it correctly here, and that what you learned growing up wasn't necessarily, though well-intentioned it might have been, it may not seem as biblical as what you knew growing up. But you've not yet put on Christ in baptism. You haven't obeyed the gospel just yet. And one of the largest stumbling blocks that you have before you are your family, your parents, perhaps even grandparents, or a spouse, or brothers or sisters, or somebody else who still belongs to a group that teaches differently about certain things, salvation being among them. And you fear that if you were to take that step and obey the gospel, what would it say of your family? Years ago at one of the congregations I was serving, one of our college students had been studying the Bible with his girlfriend who belonged to another religious tradition. And she was a very fine person, as was her family. And he called me and he said, "We're coming in for the weekend and she's going to stay at my parents' house. But I've gotten to a point in studying the Bible with her that she has questions I don't know quite how to answer them." So I said, "Well, let me know and we'll study together and I'll do my best to answer her questions." So on a Friday evening when they got in town from college, they came by the church office and we sat down and, you know, exchanged pleasantries. "Nice to meet you. Hi, how are you?" All that good stuff. And I asked her, I said, "Well, I understand you have some questions that you haven't found satisfactory answers to. And if you want to, just let me know what they are and we'll try to find the answers in the Bible." So she started posing questions. One of them was, "Well, what about the thief on the cross?" And so we looked at several passages and what I did, I'd open my Bible to a passage, turn it around, say, "Read from here to here and let me know when you're done." And she'd read and I'd say, "Does that answer your question?" And she'd say, "Yes or no." And if no, "Okay, well, let's look at it again. And do you see where it says this particular thing here? You see how that might answer your question?" So we go about this. She poses her questions and we get to the point that she's convinced that, you know, how she was taught one ought to be saved, that is by inviting Jesus into their hearts. She said, "I'm convinced that's not what God wants." I said, "Okay, so what, if anything, is holding you back right now?" She said, "I don't want to let my parents down." I said, "You know, that's one of the great commandments, honor thy father and thy mother." I said, "And I can appreciate that." I said, "But are you convinced that this is what you should do? That this is what God wants of you? Not what I want or what your boyfriend wants, but what God wants of you." And she said, "I really am, but I'm just afraid that I'll disappoint my parents." So here are some of the passages that we next turned to and that I had her to read to try and set the matter straight or to give a little bit of clarity. There we go. Luke chapter 12, verses 51 through 53. Jesus says, "Do you suppose I came to give peace on earth? I tell you, not at all, but rather division. For from now on, five in one house will be divided, three against two and two against three. Father will be divided against son, son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law," well, that's nothing new, "and daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law," right? And I asked her, I said, "Does this passage give you any insight as to what God is saying about obeying Him, as to what Christ is saying?" And that is, sometimes when you do what you are convinced God would have you to do, sometimes it's going to cause family turmoil. Because your family may see it one way, and you may see it a different way. And we looked at the passage that was read a moment ago. I said, "I want you to realize that Jesus Himself even said, those who are my mother and brothers and sisters are those who do the will of God. And not necessarily, as we use the old phrase, blood is thicker than water. Now, if you come from a great family, a strong family, blood is thicker than water because you've got that closeness. But you've got to realize that not everybody has that same relationship with their family. My biological father, and I think I've told you this before, I was asking him questions. I was probably a teenager, and I noticed he never went to church. I said, "Dad, do you believe in God?" He said, "Yeah, I believe in God." "Dad, do you believe in Jesus?" "Yeah, I believe in Jesus." I said, "Well, why aren't you a Christian? Why don't you go to church?" He said, "Look, I'm not going to order my life around it." Okay? I can at least respect his frank answer. But there it was. And I'll tell you now, not because he hates me or I hate him, but we do not have a very close relationship. One of the reasons is, partially I believe, because he has not made God a priority in his life. I don't wish anything ill to him, nor he to me, but we do not have a father-son relationship because God's not important to him. And this isn't true of all people, but for those to whom God is unimportant, their lives take a certain direction. Now, they may still be what we might call moral. They may still be what we might call honest. But if you put God at the forefront of your life and you've got people in your life, if they're family or not, who do not, and they take a different course of life than you, you've got a choice to make. You can stand by that blood is thicker than water mess, or you can do precisely what God would have you to do. And a lot of people choose the blood is thicker than water. Friends, I'm going to tell you, some of the closest family that I have are not my blood family. They're my church family. It's my church family who sent me birthday cards and called and wished me a happy birthday. It's my church family who has consistently asked, "How's your wife doing?" I may get a text now and then, or maybe even a call from blood relatives, but brethren, I'll tell you, it's my church family that does a lot more of that stuff than my blood family. And sometimes the greatest source of agony for me has been my blood family. So you can't convince me that blood is always thicker than water. At least not as the statement means. Now, if you're speaking scientifically, yeah, blood is thicker than water. But if you're talking about relatives should be a lot stronger and closer to you than strangers, well, maybe in theory that should be the case, but it isn't always. Now, this particular young girl, this young lady, college student, she happened to have a very good relationship with her parents. She loved them and they loved her. They were very close. Now, when I obeyed the gospel and when my wife obeyed the gospel, we were close with our parents and with our grandparents and those who believe differently than we do in churches of Christ. But it never for one second entered into my mind that, oh, what about my family? It was more a matter of what does God want of us? And I know some people, when they present salvation, it's always heaven and hell. And brethren, it is a heaven and hell issue, I tell you, whether you obey and do what God wants you to or not. But rather than try and scare you into heaven, I'd rather get you to fall in love with the God of heaven and compel you to want to draw near to Him and away from anything else. So we looked at this passage and I told her, I said, you realize that Jesus is saying that especially in His day, and it's still true of our day too, that when you choose God, when you choose Christ, sometimes it will put you at odds with those that you love the most. And Luke, on ahead in chapter 14, verses 26 and 27, gives us a further statement through Christ. If anyone comes to me, Jesus says, and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whoever doesn't bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Now, you look at these passages right here, and I want to point out to you that Jesus is speaking in hyperbole. It's a figure of speech. He is not saying that you have to literally hate all these relatives of yours. He's not meaning this is literally as much as he says, if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. If your arm causes you to sin, cut it off. He's speaking in hyperbole. But what he is saying is that our love for God, our love for Christ, should be so much stronger than our love for relatives. Moreover, even our own lives. And so we're getting into uncomfortable waters at this point. I've asked her from the Luke 12 passage, does Jesus say that following Him sometimes bring family unrest? She says, yeah, I get that. Okay, Luke chapter 14. What is Jesus telling you here? She's telling me that I should love Him more than my mother and father. Now, if you're not convinced that what you should do, as we've studied it, is what you should do, then well and fine. We've got to go back and start at a different starting point. But if you are convinced of such, and this is your only hang-up, this is your only stumbling block thus far, is Jesus helping you to deal with it? And now it's not easy, but it is right, at least in the eyes of God. And so we go on, and another variation that Matthew gives us of this, he who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Now these are the passages that I use when studying the Bible with someone and they're ready to obey the gospel, but their only hang up is family. What mom and dad believed, what grandma and grandpa believed, what everybody else believes. These are the passages, but I'll dare say that these passages are as relevant to Christians today as they are to those contemplating obeying the gospel. And let me explain what I mean by that. There are a lot of Christians today who take hard stances on particular issues, some of which are scriptural and call sin, sin. And they're outspoken about sin being sin, and that's great and fine. But it's amazing how I found in working with several churches that this sin is a sin until one of my relatives commits it. Then I have a way to explain what led them to commit the sin, and so they should be given leniency. Whereas if you listen to what they say about everybody else and their mama, it's sin, it's horrible, we've got to confront it. Preacher, you've got to preach more on this from the pulpit. Listen, if that's what you want, preach, go find yourself a church, get you a microphone, and preach it. But, and let me just say this, some of you are not going to love Jesus or the Lord as much during particular times of the year because you'll be out and about doing the things that warm weather allows us to do. God's going to take a backseat for some of you during the spring, summer, and fall because of ball seasons, because of whatever other seasons that come into play. And so when I say this passage is as relevant to Christians as it is to those contemplating obeying the gospel, that's what I mean. You'll skip church. Well, we were traveling, we were out, we had a doubleheader to hit or whatever you want to call it, this, that, and the other. Can't love your children more than God. We were out late last night with the kids, they had this, that, and the other. Mama had this, that, and the other. Can't love them more than God. So let's try and be balanced on these passages. I don't just use them for those contemplating obeying the gospel, but I'll use them of Christians as well. So we're getting further and further into this. And then I want to point out to you that when Jesus saw His mother as He's being crucified, He looks down at His mother and He says, "Woman, behold your son." Then He looks to John the apostle, "Son, behold your mother." Now, Jay just read a moment ago that Jesus had brothers, that He had sisters, and in Mark chapter 6, some of those brothers and sisters were mentioned by name. But when Jesus is on the cross, He doesn't give the care of His mama to one of His siblings, which would have been the right thing to do. He gave the care of His mother to one of His disciples that was following God. Do you think they had a conversation about that? How come Jesus gave mama's care to John? Why didn't Jesus give mama's care to the next eldest? Maybe because what Jesus said, those who do the will of God are my mother and my brothers and my sisters. He puts it into practice here. And so we go through this conversation, and here's what she says. And this is probably something you're wondering about. Stephen, I've got a grand something or other, I can't remember his father or mother, that passed away believing as my parents do right now. If I do what I'm convinced to do, I'm afraid that I'm pretty much saying they're in hell. That's an honest enough statement. So let's deal with it. First of all, there is but one judge, and it ain't me, it's not you, it's God. Oh, well, you're just trying to sidestep it. No, I'm not. That's the reality. God is the judge. My duty is to faithfully preach His counsel. And if you find any error in my preaching or teaching, I depend on you to point it out. Because Lord knows I don't want to do that. But I think, really, we need to get away from trying to judge everybody else's salvation. Let God do it. Now, we can present, here's what the Bible says. And based on how I understand it, this is what I believe God expects of me and all humanity. Because let me tell you something, I've got relatives too who are living in and have passed away in other traditions. And boy, I sure love them as much as that young girl loved her grand whatever it was, mother or father. But even though I love them, I'm still compelled to do what I believe God wants me to do. And I'll keep on doing what I believe God wants me to do until I'm shown that I've been doing it wrong. And then I'll change. And listen, you have my word. Now back when I was a boy growing up, when Daddy or Uncle Bo or Granddaddy said, "You have my word," that's better than a legal contract. Doesn't carry much water these days. But I promise, you have my word that if I believed that the way to be saved was to invite Jesus into my heart, I'd do it and I'd preach it. If I believed the way to be saved was to pray the sinner's prayer, I'd pray it and I'd preach it. If I believe that I should have been christened or immersed as an infant, I sure would have hoped my parents would have done it, and I'd sure be preaching it. Paul wrote to the Philippians, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." He didn't tell me to work everybody else's out. But I am to faithfully preach the gospel. And the gospel is 1 Corinthians 15:1 through 4, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And following with that, the reality is from Romans chapter 6 and Romans chapter 3, chapter 3, 23, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." Back up a little bit in Romans 3, "There is not one righteous, no, not one." In Romans chapter 6, "For the wages of sin is death." So there's not one of us who hasn't sinned. Every one of us has. And so therefore, the way out of our predicament has been provided through Jesus Christ and His sacrifice on the cross and God's mercy and grace. And He has said to all that we must believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Now this isn't an invitation, so don't start packing up. We have to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And if we believe that Jesus Christ is God's Son, we have to be willing to confess such before men, to call on the name of the Lord so that we can receive salvation. And we must be willing to turn away from our sins and to turn toward God to embrace His righteous and holy ways. And as we do that, we are also to be buried with Him, immersed literally in the watery grave of baptism. And in baptism, as I explained Sunday night for those who might have been here when Delaney was baptized, Colossians chapter 2, verse 12, God operates through our faith to save us. Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 4, we reenact the crucifixion of Christ by dying, being buried, and raising from the waters to walk in newness of life. In 1 Corinthians 12, 13, the Holy Spirit, during all this, is operating, adding us to the church. Now, some people want to dilute baptism, but you can't dilute it. Water has to be involved. Hear, believe, confess, repent, be baptized. That is what I'm convinced from the Scriptures that the earliest Christians did in the first century and that we shall keep on doing today. And so we get to that point, and I'm talking to her. Are you convinced of this same thing? Yes. But the grandparent that passed away believing thus and such, if I do this and they hadn't done it, what if they're in hell? I said, okay, let's just play devil's advocate for one moment. First of all, I'm not saying that they are, and I'm not saying that they aren't, but because that's a concern of yours, let me ask you this. Did your grandparent love you? Yes. Did your grandparent want the best for you? Yes. Now let me ask you, if your grandparent is in fact in hell, that is a concern of yours, do you really think they want you coming to where they are? No. We have here in Luke 16 the story of Lazarus and the rich man, a scripture. And the rich man, who was in Hades being tormented, he says, I beg you therefore, Father, speaking to Abraham, Father Abraham, that you would send him to my father's house, that is, Lazarus the beggar. For I have five brothers that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. Even in the afterlife, I want you to realize that this rich man was in torment. He knew where he was. He knew that he was in agony and in pain, and he knew he didn't want his brothers to come to where he was. So playing devil's advocate only, I ask her, would your grandparent who loves you, who wants the best for you, if they are in fact in hell, do they want you to join them there? Now, I'm not saying that they are, and I'm not saying that they aren't. Again, we have but one judge, and that is God, and we'll leave it up to Him. And I'll say this much. I, as well as everybody else on the day of judgment, will be as dependent upon His mercy and His grace to go into that kingdom of heaven. And so we go on with this conversation, and I ask her, I say, if your grandparents had this same information that you have today, if they had studied the Scriptures as we had today, do you think they would do what you're thinking about doing? She said, oh, without a doubt. And so I look at her and I say, what are you waiting for? And I look at you today and I ask you, what are you waiting for? Again, brethren, let's let God be the judge. Let us faithfully preach His counsel as best as we understand it. And if you are so compelled to obey the gospel, don't let family be a hang-up for you, because Jesus didn't let family be a hang-up for Him. His mother and His brothers and His sisters were those who did the will of God. And one of the greatest blessings that you gain by becoming a Christian is spiritual adoption. Adoption as a child of God, but also becoming a member of the family of God, that is the church. If you're compelled to obey, do so now as we stand together and sing.
This has been It Is Written, presented by the Glendale Road Church of Christ. We welcome your visits and communications at any time.
With God's own heart, oh, let the ancient words in